This program was paid for by Water of Life Church. From Water of Life Ministries in Plano, Texas, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob is speaking through his servants to the world. He that hath ears to hear, let him hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying today. Let us join Doyle Davidson and others of Water of Life, sowing the Word of God in spirit and in truth.
Hello, I'm Doyle Davidson, servant and apostle of the Lord Jesus Christ, ministering locally to the body of Christ in Dallas and Fort Worth, Texas, sent by God to your house to declare to you the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. 1 Corinthians 15:3-4 tell us what the gospel is, how that Jesus Christ died for our sins according to the scripture. He was buried and he rose again the third day according to the scripture. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he's anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor, send me to heal the brokenhearted, preach deliverance to the captives, recovering the sight to the blind, and set at liberty them that are bruised. The word is neither even in your heart, in your mouth. It is the word of faith which I preach. You will confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, believe in your heart that God and raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. With the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and the mouth confession is made unto salvation. I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. It is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek. Therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by his faith. I want to welcome all to this broadcast on live stream, Roku, YouTube, and shortwave. Thank God. We're going to change a bit tonight. Kathie D is going to come up and speak after the Water by Boys minister, and then Water by Boys is going to minister after her, and then I will say a few words. Perhaps I'll just say we're going to pray. Jesus said, my house should be called a house of prayer, but you've made it a den of thieves. So what are my boys going to come? They're already up here to minister, I Am. The next song that they minister will be, I Am, he said to me. What are my boys?
Hello. I had an interesting week last week. I had, there was a day that, or a couple days, that I had lost my peace. Have you ever been there? I was uneased. I was perturbed, as my mother used to say. I was not happy. I was not at peace. I was not in the spirit. And I remember Doyle and I had a couple words, and Doyle left to go to work, and I took some time. I usually read the word after he goes, and I was sitting in the chair. I went to my chair that I usually read at. I sat down, and I said, "Father, what is wrong with me?" And the answer he gave me within 2 minutes just blew me away. He said, "Kathie," he said, "you're on the earth, and you don't belong there. You don't belong there." So I'm going to remind us tonight what we have all been taught in this church by Doyle Davidson about not living on the earth, because we don't belong there anymore. If you will turn with me to John 17, verse 13, this is the prayer that Jesus prayed to the Father before he went to the cross. I'm going to begin in verse 13. He said, "And now I come to thee." He's talking to the Father. I love those words. "Now, Father, I'm coming home." He said, "Now I come to thee, and these things I speak in the world, that they might have my joy fulfilled in themselves." See, I didn't have joy that day. In 14, "I have given them thy word, and the world has hated them." Why? "Because they are not of the world, even as I am not of the world." You see, Jesus took those disciples and made them where they don't belong on the earth. They are no longer on the earth, "because they are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. And I pray not thou should take them out of the world, but that thou should keep them from the evil." 16, "They are not of the world, even as I am not of the world." How do we get out of this world? By believing and walking in the gospel. You will see that for us to not belong here, but to be seated in heavenly places, we have to walk in the gospel. We have to take up our cross every day. That's the only way, frankly, we get out of here. All right, let's turn to Ephesians 2. We all remember this verse. Ephesians 2, verse 4. "But God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, when we were at our very worst, has quickened us together with Christ. By grace are you saved, and has raised us up together." Do you know that when Jesus was raised from the dead, the reason he was raised from the dead is because the sacrifice that he made for us to the Father was accepted. The Father was satisfied with the sacrifice, so the Father forgave all the sin that Jesus paid for. He justified us. And to do that, he raised Jesus from the dead. Jesus no longer had to pay in hell. Jesus had already paid what was needed to pay for us. So the Father, therefore, the word says, therefore, God raised him from the dead. And when God raised Jesus from the dead, that's when you and I were raised. Amen. That's when we were forgiven. That's when we were justified. And he took that blood that he gave as a sacrifice to heaven, and he poured it out, his own blood. And that's what redeemed us. That's what made us in the same state that Jesus was. So now we have Jesus in us if you are born again. And if you are born again, you are one spirit with Jesus. Your spirit and his spirit become one. Well, guess where Jesus lives? He doesn't live on the earth. He lives in heaven. And that's where our home is now if we believe the gospel. Let's go on in that verse. It says, "Even when we were dead in sins, has quickened us together with Christ. For by grace are you saved." We didn't ask for this. We didn't deserve it. But we got it anyway, thank God. And then 6, and has raised us up together with Jesus and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. If you've got Jesus in you, you don't belong here. You belong where he is, and he's in heaven. Let's turn to Philippians 3, verse 18. Paul speaking, he says, "For many walk, of whom I have told you often, and I'll tell you even weeping, that they are the enemies of the cross of Christ, whose end is destruction, whose God is their belly, and whose glory is in their shame, who mind earthly things." Do you see what how destruction comes? It's when you mind earthly things. The next verse, "For our conversation," that word means behavior, it means government, it means citizenship. "Our citizenship is in heaven, from whence also we look for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall change our vile body, that it may be fashioned like unto his glorious body, according to the working whereby he is able even to subdue all things unto himself." Aren't those glorious words? He is able to subdue all things unto himself, including our behavior. But our conversation, our behavior, our citizenship is in heaven. Why? Because we are with Jesus and he is in us. And the gospel took us there. You cannot get there without the gospel. Your righteousness won't get you a foot off the ground. The only way you live in heaven is to walk in the justification, the righteousness, the redemption, the forgiveness of the gospel. And that gospel, that Jesus was raised and you raised with him, makes you a citizen of heaven. Next verse, Colossians 3, verse 1. It says, "If you then be risen with Christ." Are you risen with Christ? Yes, you are if you believe the gospel. You have to believe it, just like I said this morning. You can read the Bible every day for hours and not believe and go to hell. Did you know that? It has to do with believing. You have to trust in, adhere to the gospel. It says, "If you are then risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Set your affection on things above." Set your affections on things above, not on things of the earth, for you are dead. For you are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. You know, as you walk this, you will find that the things that you had pleasure with on earth, the things that you desired, your lust for the things on the earth, they dissipate, they dissolve, they go away. And what you are doing is you are setting your affection on God, on things above. But now you say, well, what things? Well, let's go on with this for a little bit, because it gives us some more idea. Verse 4, "When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then you shall also appear with him in glory. Mortify therefore your members which are upon the earth." And this is the earthly things. These are the earthly things. Now remember, we don't belong on the earth anymore. We don't belong on the earth anymore. Thank God. Beam me up, Scotty. Says, "When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall we also appear with him in glory. Mortify, put to death, therefore, your members which are upon the earth." These things: fornication, uncleanness, inordinate affection, evil concupiscence, covetousness, which is idolatry. "For which thing's sake the wrath of God cometh on the children of disobedience, in the which you also walked sometimes when you lived in them. But now you also put off all these: anger, wrath, being perturbed, malice, blasphemy, filthy communication out of your mouth. Lie not one to another, seeing that you have put off the old man with his deeds and have put on the new man, which is renewed in knowledge after the image of him that created him." Verse 11, "Where there is neither Greek nor Jew, circumcision nor uncircumcision, barbarian, Scythian, bond or free, but Christ is all." You see that? Christ is all and in all. It's Jesus in you. It's Jesus in you. That's the goal, right? Let's go to Ephesians 1. What are those things? What are those things that we're looking for? Let's go in verse 16. What do we need to set our affections on? If we can't set them on the earthly things, what do we need to set them on? Verse 16, cease not to give thanks for you. This is Paul making mention of you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him. That's one thing you desire, wisdom and knowledge of the Lord Jesus. That's what you set your affection on. The next verse, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling and what is the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints. Do you know if you don't belong here and you belong in heaven, do you know you have an inheritance? Do you know what that inheritance is? Have you ever looked into what your inheritance is? It is profound. It is huge. It is immeasurable. It is whatever you need in any circumstance that you are in. Verse 19, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power to usward who believe, according to the working of his mighty power, which he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead and set him at his own right hand in heavenly places. Hey, that's where we're supposed to be. That's where we're supposed to be. And what goes along with that? The exceeding greatness of his power. We don't belong here on the earth. This is where we belong. This is where we set our affections, on that exceeding great power, that inheritance of ours. That's where our affection needs to be. And it says, verse 21, far above principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this world, but in that which is to come. Have you ever thought about the world to come? Have you ever thought about the world to come? You know, when God started dealing with me, with Doyle, I had some hard days, real hard days. In fact, I remember thinking at one point, I thought, I don't know if this is worth it. I don't even know if it's worth it to live. And you know, God started ministering to me. That's because you're not thinking about what's coming. You're not thinking about the next life. My heart was totally on the earth. I never even considered that in 20 years, all this isn't going to matter. It's not going to matter one bit. Who I was seated next to, or what restaurant I went to, or what this one thought, or what that one thought, or what this one didn't think. It doesn't matter. In 20 years, it's not going to matter. You know what's going to matter? Me meeting Jesus face to face. Me speaking to the Father face to face. That day that I stand before God, that's going to matter. You know what? That's a little bit easier to get off this earth when you consider that. And you know, the things that break our hearts now, or make us sad, or grieve us, because we're here, we're not up there. When we're up there, it's not going to matter. You know, I remember when God told me, when we were going through this with this deal with the marriage certificate, God told me one time I was praying about it, and I was doing my best to walk through what God wanted. And God said, do you want heaven on earth? And I said, well, yes, of course. He said, well, Kathie, you know there's no marriage in heaven. Ooh, you know what? It's a little easier. It was a little easier. All right. Now let's go to, let's see. Now, how do we do this? Let's go to Romans 8. How do we live up there? Romans 8 verse 14. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. You have to walk in the Spirit. How do you walk in the Spirit? You first start by believing the gospel. You've got to believe the gospel. You walk in the gospel. You take that gospel up every day. And then go to verse 26. Likewise, the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities. We're going to do this in just a little bit. For we know not how we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit itself maketh intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. And he that searches the hearts knoweth what is the mind of the Spirit, because he maketh intercession for the saints according to the will of God. According to the will of God. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God and to who are called according to his purpose. All things work to the good to them that love God. Oh, there's the sticking point. This doesn't go for everybody. All things don't work for good for everybody. Who's it work good for? For those that love God. Now, we've known this. How do you know you love God? You keep his commandments. Do you love God? If you say you love God, you keep his commandments. Are you keeping his commandments? Are you walking in the Spirit? Are you walking in the gospel, taking it up daily? Then all things will work good for you. I have a perfect little example for you, real quick. It's not a big one, but it really blessed me. Back when I lived in Frisco, we had a situation. We didn't have a lot of money. There were times that we didn't have any. And at one point, my headlight in my car stopped working. So my husband took out the assembly of the headlight to see what the problem was, because it wasn't the bulb. Took it apart, saw what the problem was, fixed it, put it back together. There was quite a bit to the assembly. Put the assembly back together. Got it all done. Turned around. There was a piece laying on the ground, a spring about this big, a spring out of the assembly for a headlight. We couldn't figure out where it went, but we didn't want to take the assembly back apart because it was working. It worked fine. So we put the little spring up on a cabinet and thought, well, you know, if a problem shows up, we know it's the spring, and we'll put the spring back in the car. Well, guess what? A couple days later, my dishwasher broke. The flap that lets all the soap out quit. It wouldn't open up. The door wouldn't open up. It wouldn't open up. Well, you know why? We took it apart. The spring broke. The spring in the dishwasher broke. Well, guess what? That spring that came off of the Ford Explorer fit exactly where the spring in the dishwasher was supposed to be. And it worked perfect. That was when I was trying to keep my heart on God. All things worked together for good. And I think we spent no money on the whole two situations. That is when you walk in the gospel, when you love God by keeping his commandments, you walk in the gospel. Now, what happens when you are walking in this Spirit, when you are walking in the Spirit, when you are walking in that gospel, when you are seated in heavenly places with Jesus and not living on the earth? Turn with me. We're going to finish in Hebrews 4, verse 3. For we which have believed, what? Believed the gospel. Believed Jesus, the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. Put our trust in the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. For we which have believed do enter into rest. As he said, as I have sworn in my wrath, if they shall enter into my rest, although the works were finished from the foundation of the world. For he spoke in a certain place of the seventh day on this wise, and God did rest the seventh day from all his works. And then this place again, if they shall enter into my rest. Seeing therefore it remaineth that some must enter therein, and they to whom it was first preached entered not in because of unbelief. What is this rest? Again, he limiteth a certain day, saying to David, today, after so long a time, as it is said, today, if you will hear his voice, harden not your hearts. For if Jesus, if Joshua had given them rest, then they would not afterward have spoken of another day. There remaineth therefore a rest to the people of God. This is what that rest is. For he that has entered into his rest, he has also ceased from his own works, as God did from his. When you are walking in the Spirit, you don't do your own works. You don't expect your own things. You don't do it on your own. God does it for you. God directs your path. God tells you where to go. He tells you where to work. He tells you where to eat, where not to eat, who to see, who not to see. That Spirit guides you in everything you do. You say, well, that's impossible. I'm a mother. I have a job. I have children. It is possible. It is possible. How? You set your affections on things above. You set your heart on the gospel. You put off, you put to death the deeds of the flesh. You know, I bet you Jesus is not one bit interested in seeing the new Star Wars movie. I bet Jesus is not one bit interested in going to go see that new restaurant that just opened up downtown. I bet Jesus is not one bit interested in that new book or this new gallery or these new things that are happening. I bet Jesus isn't one bit interested. Well, then why are we? Then why are we? Because we are living on the earth and we are not living in heaven. Do you know I haven't seen a movie in about, at least 7 years. I know it's been more than that. We don't even watch TV anymore. We don't even watch the TV anymore. Why? Because we don't live here. We live in heaven. And you know what? When you live in heaven, you live in heaven on earth. Let's have the water five boys come up. Let them minister to us. And let's walk. Let's be seated in those heavenly places.
Dark in my heart, you brought life to me, a child of darkness became a child of light, and when my soul so dry, and I need a drink, the water of life, you became for me. Children to lead the way.
though the Lord set a new table, I thought we'd pray. We're going to talk first. I've been in this building 35 years speaking. I don't even know how many times that I've taught, whatever, recorded, whatever, Bible school, Water of Life Christian Training School. I don't have any idea how many times. In 14, sometime, I'm not sure when, toward April, May, perhaps, I was praying, and I started seeing streets of gold. I thought, what's this? What is this? And I started seeing gold buildings, flat roof, black. What's this? And I started seeing wall, gold buildings, maybe, I don't know, how long, a whole bunch of them, just one after another, long, but from the eye where I was at, they look, oh, maybe 30 feet long. Just one after another. Amazing. I saw a beautiful building once had a white top. Gold with a white top. I thought that must be a pearl. Folks, I was enjoying praying. I knew after a while I was seated in heavenly places, praying in heavenly places, where KD talked about. Every time I'd pray, I'd get up there. I was praying. And here one night, we were singing, praising God. And I was standing right there. And I started looking down on streets, street lights, red, green, blue. And what's this? Oh, I'm in heaven looking down the earth. Folks, I've had some fun praying, just watching the sights. Somewhere about the 1st of July of 14, well, I can tell you, 28th day of June, I started encountering new things. New thing, sins of God's people. Sins of God's people laid upon me. My body was under a great attack. I fought and prayed. Had bumps, quarter size of my legs, upper and thighs, full of edema, blood, and red splotches, big as one of them, about a dollar bill. Encounter sins of God's people laid upon me. It's incredible. But I'd still be praying in the heavenlies. Well, it's beautiful. I can always tell when I get into the heavenlies. Immediately it shows up. If I'm praying with someone, I'll say, well, we just prayed into the heavenlies. This is where we're seated. See, I've gotten to where I can bring, take people there with me. It's beautiful. 14. Rest of 14. Not easy. 15. It got tougher. But I pray my way in to heavenly places. Seated in heavenly places. Looking down. Well, it's beautiful seeing all the highways lit up. It's amazing. It's like a movie in a vision. I'm traveling. It's amazing to watch it. May the 5th, went on World Harvest Television. I didn't pay much attention to it at first. And I kind of lost sight of praying in the heavens. But it didn't bother me. I don't pray to see the heavens where God's at, the third heaven. No, I pray obedient to God to get success. Thank God to bring forth fruit. To grind corn, to travail, and birth, till Christ be formed in you and in some of you that he left you because you were in deep sin. Deep sin. You see, God shows me a lot of this stuff. Amazing. You know, we're today, according to the industry numbers, our Sunday broadcast on television covers 65 million people. It's available to 65 million. Actually, it's a little more. But when you get to that high, what's another 2 or 3 million? I just rounded it off. So you think we don't do anything here, huh? Did you know this gospel we preach is made known to the powers and principalities in heavenly places, Ephesians 3:10. Made known to the powers and principalities the manifold wisdom of God by the church. That's us. That's all we do. For those of you that's troubled about some things you see, you don't even know what you're talking about. What you see is temporal. What you hear may be a lie. Now, I see frequently. I've been noticing frequently the heavens, not as vast or as large a vision as I've seen, but at least I know I'm back there praying. Why? I've overcome. Thank God. Guess what? I can feel it. I can sense it. October through December was not a bit of fun in 15. Not one bit. But guess what? You didn't hurt me. You didn't hurt me. You hurt yourself. You rebelled against God. You touched God's anointed. You didn't hurt me. God opposed me. I just keep walking. Now, new things have developed. Thank God. Distant cousins from the Northeast have contacted us. It's beautiful. Thank God. One of the blessings that I have had this past week was Roger Williams. I guess that stuff had been read to me by my staff, but I forgot it. You see, I'm not complaining. It's not in me to complain. For 7 years, I've not been able to drive an automobile, walk on the sidewalk alone about 4 or so years. Sins of God's people coming down on me, troubling me. You can find that in the 6th chapter of the book of Galatians. It happened to the Apostle Paul. Paul, you might find that.
I'm there.
Well, that's good. Read it.
Verse 11 says, "You see how large a letter I've written unto you with mine own hand." And then if you jump down to verse 17, "From henceforth let no man trouble me, for I bear in my body the marks of the Lord Jesus."
You see who troubles me? Men. Male and female. That's caused this. Sin. Trouble. But you know, I went through about 3 years. I could hardly tell there was a light in this room. Kind of fun. Look around, see the lights. Look up here, see them. Identify some bulbs where before, just all the last couple weeks, and looking more distinct, but they've been just a blur of light. Guess what? I'm excited. Why don't I act like it? Amen. I'm pleased. What's going on? Water of life. And you got some considerations that you got to look at. Oh, good Lord. God orders my steps in His Word. Every one of them. And I'm happy to obey. Happy to obey Him. To do His will. From my heart. In the Spirit of God. I just praise the Lord for Water of Life Ministries, all of you, that God gave to me and that I keep here by the power of God. Did you know you're not here because you want to be? Well, I know that. I am. I'm here because I want to be. But you haven't walked where I've walked. You don't know what we do, what I know. You start seeing heaven. And you know you're standing here, sitting here, praying, and you're looking around, heaven's everywhere. And that wouldn't excite you. You have lost touch. Amen. Thank God. Bless the Lord, so. I think we've got long enough to pray in tongues. What do you say? Let's go. Oskianda Bashi, Ba Shangadai. Boko Shiba, Baku Shiba, Boko, Made it back, Deko Boshi, Kaba, Make it back, Make it back, Make God up back, Baku Shiba, Made it back, Make 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 it back. Thank God is back. Thank God is back. Thank God. Oh, my God is back. Thank God. 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 Yeah.
Yes.
We invite you to visit Water of Life Church at 1621 18th Street in Plano, Texas. Or for further information, call area code 972-578-8082. That's 972-578-8082. Or write Doyle Davidson, Post Office Box 861327, Plano, Texas 75086. That's Doyle Davidson, Post Office Box 861327, Plano, Texas 75086. This program was paid for by Water of Life Church.